Norman Lear is here. The New Yorker magazine has called him the original pugnacious showrunner long before that term existed. He is responsible for groundbreaking sitcoms like All in the Family, The Jeffersons, Good Times, and Maude. He has received 4 Emmys, a Peabody, and the National Medal of Arts. His new book is called Even This I Get to Experience. I am pleased to have Norman Lear back at this table. Welcome, sir.
He is pleased to be here.
Well, I hope so. Why did it take you so long to write this?
It only took me 87 years. I had nothing else to do. I wanted to write it 20 years before I actually wrote it, and made notes and had people saving scripts and going through correspondence. And I had a pile of stuff when I finally started 5 years ago. It took me about 4.5 years.
You said the reflection on your life for this book made you realize how hard it had been to be a human being.
Haven't you noticed?
Yes, I have.
It is hard to be a human being. The circumstances of birth can vary, and some have it so hard. I don't mean to compare myself to people across the globe, but just being a human being is difficult, no matter the circumstances.
Well, you had it hard because your dad went to prison.
He did.
Your mom sort of turned you over to relatives.
Yeah. My father went to prison for 3 years when I was 9 years old. I lived with an uncle, then another uncle. Wound up with my grandparents and saw my mother very infrequently in the 3 years my dad was away.
Now, why was
and
that?
My sister.
Why was that?
I'll never understand that, because I used to say to her, you know, through the years, as a grown man, where were you? How didn't I see you? And she'd say, I was there. What do you mean I wasn't there? Mother, I have no memory of you. She would say, please. That was the end of every conversation.
Please,
that was
stop
in the discussion.
It,
yeah.
Now, did she live to see you successful as you were? I mean, with the sort of enormous
she
success
did,
you had?
But she never really acknowledged that I had gotten past 11 or 12 years of age. She never addressed my mature years. She didn't talk about them. She didn't. I was just the best son that ever was. But every anecdote she had to tell was about Norman falling down the stairs when he was to get a laugh when he was a kid.
Yeah. So being an outsider makes you want to get a laugh, doesn't it?
Well, being an outsider on the dole, I was living with an uncle I thought I had to perform for, another uncle I thought I had to perform for and take care of his kids. And getting a laugh was the best way to feel comfortable.
Why show business?
Why show business? Yeah. I had one uncle who used to flick me a quarter. I was a kid of the Depression. Yeah. I had an Uncle Jack. He used to flick me a quarter. He was a press agent. That was the only role model I had. I wanted to be an uncle who could flick a quarter. Yeah. That was my goal.
And how did you get started?
I got started, I went to California to become I was a press agent in New York. Want to hear how I got fired?
Yes.
I got fired because I was making $35 a week, and we had a show called Are You With It, which was a review. One of the acts in that review was Buster Shaver and his midgets. The lead midget was named Olive. I wrote, and a columnist by the name of Dorothy Kilgallen.
She was later
printed
on What's My Line.
Yes, she was on What's My Line. New York Journal American she wrote for. I wrote that Buster Shaver and Olive were seen shopping Fifth Avenue, he on foot, she on a St. Bernard. And somebody must have said, Dorothy, what on earth are you doing with items like this? Anyway, she called my boss and I was canned.
So she got you fired.
So she got me fired. I came to California to become a press agent again and ran into a fellow, Ed Simmons, who wanted to become a comedy writer. Our wives hit it off. We were taking care of the kids one night. He had a baby. We had a baby. They went to a movie. He was writing a parody to a song called The Sheik of Araby, I remember. We wrote it together. When the girls came home from the movies, we went out and sold it for $35-40. And that was half of what I made selling door to door.
There was a film that you had just done that was a success when you first got the opportunity, you know, to create a sitcom at CBS.
Uh-huh.
What was that?
That was That was interesting. I was being divorced. I was writing with Ed Simmons, The Martha Ray Show.
Right.
And a fellow by the name of Phil Sharp came to visit us. And he was being divorced. He had four children. I had one. I asked him, how are things going? I was having a very difficult time. He said, all she wants is my Joan Davis reruns.
Yeah.
So he was settling for a show, for the reruns of a show he had created, the Joan Davis Show. And so I said, I've got to do a sitcom.
And because of the reruns?
Because it was owning something.
Yeah. I mean, everybody knows this because of the publicity that Bill Cosby got for it, that Jerry Seinfeld got for it. You create a television show that you own. The network broadcast it.
Right.
You know, they pay for episodes, but the real payoff becomes when it goes off the network and you can syndicate it. I mean, Seinfeld is said to be $500 to $1 million. Cosby made up to $250 to $500 million.
Yes. Well, I was just smart enough to know I needed a business partner.
Yeah.
And so Bud and I found a fellow by the name of Jerry Parencio, who was a great man, great, great man. And he became our business partner, and he made it a business. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 shows on the air. I wouldn't have known how to make a business of it. He did that.
And do you have any sense of the dollar value of revenue for all those shows that you created in syndication?
We sold those shows to the Coca-Cola Company of all, the library of shows to the Coca-Cola Company a great many years ago. And the title of this book derives from the fact that despite taking down a whole bunch of money, I went into business for myself without that business partner, made the mistake of doing things the wrong way because I wasn't a businessman, almost went broke, and got a phone call when I learned about this and from my son-in-law, who asked me, how are you feeling? I said, I feel terrible. What are you talking about? I feel awful. But you know, John, something keeps running through my head. Even this I get to experience. So that's where the title of
This I Get to Experience.
Yeah.
The fact that he came off of something not very happy.
Even that I got to experience, however.
There's a wonderful line that you have about happiness. It is pursuit of along lines of excellence. What is that?
It's, I think, Aristotle's definition of happiness.
Happiness
is the exercise of your vital abilities along lines of excellence in a life that affords them scope.
Have you had that?
Oh, my God, yes. I've had that.
So you've been a happy man, according to Aristotle.
According to Aristotle and according to Norman Lear.
Yeah. So All in the Family.
Yeah.
You and Carol O'Connor's an interesting relationship.
We did.
Who were you writing about? Who did you have in mind when you created the character of Archie Bunker?
An amalgam of the people I'd known and heard about and the people we lived with, the neighbors, and a piece of my father. Mm-hmm. My father called me the laziest white kid he ever met.
Yeah.
And
that line became famous in All in the Family.
It became well known in All in the Family. Mm-hmm. And I used to scold him for putting down a race of people to call me lazy, at which point he said, you're also the dumbest white kid I ever met. So that part of it was, homegrown. I understood that part of it. The rest of it is just what I felt, read, saw among family and neighbors and so forth.
You have said that Carol O'Connor really gave it a lot. I mean, that he helped enhance the definition of Archie Bunker in an immeasurable way.
I had a script. I couldn't begin to tell you the personality I had in mind, because it depended so on the actor who would perform it. Carol O'Connor walked into a room, sat down, read 5 sentences, and
you said, he's the guy.
That was, I wrote the words, he inhabited the character.
Yeah. Take a look at this. This is a clip from All in the Family. Archie asked Sammy Davis Jr. a question. Here it is.
Another thing they're always doing to me, they're always telling me I'm prejudiced. Now listen, you're a guy been around the lot. You've seen a lot of people, you know a lot, see?
Yeah.
Now, you look at me. You figure me for prejudice kind?
Oh, Archie, you don't tell me you're really paying attention to those young kids. What do they know? I mean, you prejudice. Look, if you were prejudiced, Archie, when I came into your house, you would have called me a But you didn't say that. I heard you clear as a bell. Right straight out, you said, call it.
Yeah, that's what I've done, all right.
And if you were prejudiced, you would, like some people, close their eyes to what's going on in this great country that we live in. But not you, Archie. Your eyes are wide open. You can tell the difference between black and white. And I have a deep-rooted feeling that you'll always be able to tell the difference between black and white. And if you were prejudiced, you'd walk around thinking that you're better than anybody else in the world. But I can honestly say, having spent these marvelous moments with you, you ain't better than anybody.
Can I have your hand on that sandwich? And I hope you all heard that over there. That comes straight from Sammy Davis Jr., Mr. Wonderful himself. And that should prove to you once and for all that I ain't prejudiced.
His truth goes marching on.
You see that? You can't learn him nothing. There's Munson with the briefcase now there, Sammy. I'll let him right in.
Oh, hi, Arch.
Munson, we're waiting for you. Where were you?
I'm sorry I took so long, Arch, but I bumped into Bonnie Hefner with his camera, so naturally I had to go back and get mine. Mr. Davis, this is an unexpected pleasure.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Can I get a picture, Mr.
Davis? Come on, Munson, no pictures.
Oh, no, this one is for me. Mr. Munson, when you stand over there, I want one picture taken with Archie Bunker, my friend, and me.
You want me?
Oh, yes. Now, on three, okay? One, two, three.
You'll still love it, don't you?
Oh, my God, yes.
It's the writing. Oh, it's the, and God, the delivery. Yes.
But I saw something here that I hadn't really seen before. If I did, I'd totally forgotten it. And that is the way that man said colored was had as much weight as as Archie just said it. Mm-hmm. And does racism exist in America in 2015 to the extent that that piece mattered? Yes.
What was it about you in terms of what you wanted to do? You wanted to use comedy to have an impact on big social issues that were part of the American conversation.
Uh-huh. Well, comedy is, this is all reflection. It sounds like I knew what the hell I was doing at the time. I didn't. I was just, you know, working from the viscera. But looking back on it, comedy is an intravenous. You know, you can slip all kinds of thinking. As while people are laughing, it's like an intravenous. And so I denied for years that we were that we had a message. We were about making an audience laugh. Yeah. And I say today, too, that was the first.
Yeah, but Jerry Seinfeld used to say that Seinfeld was about nothing.
Uh-huh.
You know, but you were about something.
Well, they were about something, too, human behavior or something. But yeah, we were about what was happening in our culture that affected us. What was going on with our kids, our relationships, our politics, it was hard to be a single human being, it was hard to be five of them.
Did you and Archie fight?
Carol O'Connor, yes. And I, yeah, we disagreed about a great many things.
What?
He,
'cause he became so identified with that role.
Well, yes, and he was carrying a heavy burden. I mean, that was a big burden to be carrying. And so, I think it started there. And he had a fear I've seen in a lot of actors of stepping out in front of an audience and representing something, anything, whatever that happens to be, for millions of people. That's, you know, that's heady stuff. And he was an Irish intellectual. I mean, seriously intellectual. And he thought things had to go a certain way. I don't think he understood the way we did, meaning the writers, the way comedy worked as we understood it. And so we would have arguments.
I want to talk about Sherman Helmsley. But take a look at this clip between Carol O'Connor and George Jefferson, between Archie Bunker and George Jefferson.
Hello, Mr. Jefferson.
Oh, hi, Mrs. Bunker.
Hey, Jefferson there. How are you? Listen, that formal invitation you sent by your wife, I think that was very white of you.
That's exactly the way I felt when I did it.
George, why don't you take Archie over to the bar and offer him a drink?
Hey, Jefferson, I seen you hosing down your porch yesterday.
Oh, yeah? When am I going to see you hosing down yours?
Bartender.
Yes, sir.
Give the man a drink, please.
What'll it be, sir?
Whiskey.
Any particular brand?
Yeah, the expensive brand.
And what about you, sir?
Scotch and soda, please.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Jefferson, there's a switch for you. This guy giving you the big yes, sir.
Why, he's a bartender, ain't he?
Yeah, but what I meant was I'm used to having it the other way around.
Oh, yeah? How many servants you got in that mansion you living in?
What do you mean by that?
Let me tell you something about people.
There you are.
Thank you. That bartender's willing to work for me because if you got enough green in your pocket, then black becomes his favorite color.
Sherman Helmsley.
He was, you know, I didn't have George Jefferson for, I don't know, months. And in order to have a male adult next door introduce the character of a brother-in-law, an uncle, who was an actor who came down from San Francisco to play the role, until I or my casting director, Marion Daugherty, some one of us remembered his performance in a show called Pearlie. And as soon as I remembered
that,
you know, Sherman Hemsley, he was George Jefferson. And he came out, and the fact that he was smaller than Archie,
yeah.
You know, that he was a little bantam cock of a guy that could, you know, I don't know, that was miraculous chemistry.
Take a look at this. This is another scene from Maude, who also spun off from All in the Family. All in the Family was the mother.
Don't say it.
Here it is.
You know, I've been thinking, there is no earthly reason for you to go through with this at your age. You know it, I know it, Walter knows it.
I don't want you to talk about it. Just don't talk about it.
I didn't say anything, but now that you mentioned it, it's legal in New York now, isn't it?
Oh, of course it is, Walter. Mother, I don't understand your hesitancy. When they made it a law, you were for it.
Of course, I wasn't pregnant then.
Mother, it's ridiculous. My saying this to you, we're free. We finally have the right to decide what we can do with our own bodies.
All right, then will you please get yours into the kitchen?
You're just scared.
I am not scared.
You are, and it's as simple as going to the dentist.
Now I'm scared.
Mother, listen to me. It's a simple operation now. But when you were growing up, it was illegal. And it was dangerous, and it was sinister, and you've never gotten over that. Now you tell me that's not true.
It's not true. And you're right. I've never gotten over it.
It's not your fault. When you were young, abortion was a dirty word. It's not anymore. Now you think about that.
You have said what?
Just that you let it run so long. It's so tender. It's so right. It's just thank you for letting it run.
You have said that you see more of yourself in Maude than any other character.
Because she was a reflexive liberal. I am a reflexive liberal, you know. I don't know as much as I wish I did. I don't know, certainly at this age, as much as most people think I know. You know, at 88, 89, even, you know, 89, once I hit 90, I could get applause crossing a room. And I'm thought to be so wise at 92. And I'm the same guy I was at 75. I am reflexively full of emotion. I know a great deal about a lot of things. But I am not anybody's wise man or expert. I'm just somebody
who cares. But because you were Norman Lear, they put that into their perception of you.
Yes, and especially Norman Lear,
because of all of his success, and because he created people for the American way, and he was a voice for liberalism.
And he turned 90.
And he turned 90.
And then something happened at 90 with other people, you know.
What would you change about the life that Norman Lear has lived so far?
Now, this is going to sound, you're not concerned about diabetes or anything, because this could be very treacly.
No.
I wouldn't change a thing, because I believe that if this moment is right, and I love this moment, then everything that led up to it had to be, had to be.
Yeah, I agree with that. So, the idea is that you had to go through all the things that you went through in order to be where you are today.
Right.
So to say, I wish it hadn't been that way, would be to deny who you are.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You created a show called AKA Pablo.
Yes.
And we all thought you had the golden touch. We thought that Norman could do no wrong. But you created a show that about a Hispanic family.
About a Hispanic family.
Didn't work.
Well, I told the network that we were living the American immigrant experience.
Yeah.
You know, when the Jews came here, when the Irish came here, when the Italians came here, they lived up the street, down the street, across the street from each other. They were gathered in a place. At that time, the only fresh immigrant experience were the Latinos.
Hmm.
Who were living up the street. There would be 17 characters, I told the network, and there were 17 characters. It was going to take time to get used to them. They were some wonderful actors. I think if they had let more than six shows go, I mean, we only did six shows. If they had let 14 shows, perhaps it might have caught on, or 32 shows. That's what's happening with all the shows that are succeeding on the non-networks today.
They have time to develop.
They have time to develop.
Same thing is true about 60 Minutes, I mean, which became an icon.
Yes.
Because they had time to develop. They put them on Sunday evening at the time they did, and you know, there was time to develop and build an audience. I mean, it's like movies. If you don't make it on Friday night, you don't make it.
And the networks are the same way. They haven't learned yet. I've been trying for 3 years to get a show about your generation and mine, and maybe the one above mine and the one below yours.
Yes.
People in retirement, in a lovely retirement village, you know, where they run from 60 to 95, 105.
And that whole age group has huge spending power, don't they?
They have the most expendable income, and they are the largest growing demographic. And it's still 18 to 39. Yeah. Ask me the title of the show.
What's the title of the show?
Guess Who Died.
Oh, yeah. A conversation you can imagine every day. There is also this, though. You were a groundbreaker in terms of the television you created, one time after another. I mean, is that because there was something in you, or was that simply because that's where you found the humor in cutting-edge social issues?
I really think it's because that's where I found the humor. When I was 9 years old, and my father goes to prison, my mother is selling the furniture, I'm about to go live with the people who are practically strangers, and somebody puts their hand on my shoulder and says, "You're the man of the house now."
Yeah, at nine.
If you don't know, that's funny. Yeah. Or let me word it another way. If you do know that's funny, then there's something to work with.
Yeah. Hard to write this?
It was extremely hard to write.
Why?
Because I wanted to get close to, I say in the dedication, I wanted to open my veins. Another way of saying I really wanted to tell the truth as I saw it, find and tell it. Some of it I had to find and dig for.
Your wife, Frances Lear, former wife, had an interesting life too.
She did indeed.
Did you guys stay close, or was it?
No, we didn't stay close. We didn't have great problems. But we didn't stay close. And she says in there, she says in her own book, it's a quatrain.
I'm going to read it to you.
Oh,
please. I have it right here. She wrote, "My life is like an epic poem with lines that rhyme with he and she. He is what I might have been, and she is only me."
Yeah, that breaks my heart when I hear that. she wanted to be a star, or everything she thought I became. The night that turned her life around, she says somewhere in her book, was an Emmy broadcast when Johnny Carson was doing the show and came back from a commercial and said, "Welcome back to the Norman Lear Show." She says that her life changed with that joke. From then on, walking down the street, it was, "Hello, Mr. Lear. Oh, this is my wife." Yeah, she couldn't bear that role.
Yeah, Bill Moyers said, "Many have known the man behind the stories. Now, all of us can know the stories behind the man. Archie, Edith, Gloria, and Meathead couldn't have told them better. Your friend Carl Reiner. Norman Lear could never write a more dramatic, touching, or funnier tale of his life than he's done here. And even this, I get to experience." And then President Clinton, "Norman Lear can find humor in life's darkest moments is no surprise. It's the reason he's been so successful throughout his more than 9 decades on Earth, and why Americans have relied on his wit and wisdom for more than 6 of those decades. It's also why this I get to experience is such a great deal." Thank you, Norman.
I could listen to you read that all day. Thank you, Charlie.
I should mention that your son-in-law, the great Dr. John LaPook, is a colleague of ours at CBS.
Yes, and one of the greats. He's the guy that called me and is responsible for that title. He called me to find out how I was. I said, "Even this, I get to." The next morning, he called me and said, "You got to promise me. You said you want to be cremated. You got to promise me we can bury you." I said, "Why?" He said, "Because I want to take your children someday, your grandchildren, my children, to a stone that reads, 'Even this I get to experience.'"
Thank you, Norm.